Our third keynote speaker is well-known and respected. Is a well-known and respected colleague of mine, Ricardo Weber. They mix our names very often, but not today. Ricardo Weber became a fire officer in 1993. He has a PhD in metals science and has been working in the fire brigade of Amsterdam between 1993 and 2014 in several positions, among which the deputy CFO. In 2011, he became a professor of fire science at the National Fire Service Academy, and he is setting up and developing a pan-European network of researchers. It's his mission, his goal, to create a fire service on a higher level, safer, and with more knowledge. Ricardo Weber.
Thank you very much, Stefan. During the presentation of Robin, I was all the time thinking that I'm so happy that I have very good acquaintances, and maybe not so much knowledge. And because when you see what UL already did in the past 10 years, it is really a lot. And we are in the business maybe for 4 years now. We also did some research, but not, of course, that many. But what you also see in my presentation is that we agree on a lot of things. And that is how science works, that sometimes somebody somewhere does a research and can be happy that somebody else does the same research, and we agree that the outcome of the research is the same. That's why I'm very happy that this year we had, and also the past 2 days, we had an exchange of experts with experts from all over Europe, and even with Robin and the professor from Lund, Stefan Svensson, was also here to have discussions with us about questions that we still have. We are still learning a lot of things. And especially what we are learning is how to apply theory. Because it seems like also like Robin started, we know a lot about the theory of fires. But the question is, how can we apply the theory to put out the fire? And how can we make it as simple as possible that the firefighter that is in front of the building that is burning can apply it very easily? And that is what, for me, is one of my biggest goals, is of course to get all the knowledge that we have in the world, to combine it, to find confirmation about things. And some of the discussions, although probably not all the discussions can be ended, because fire is really very difficult. If there is one conclusion about the past 2 days in the discussion with all the experts, is that fire is maybe, we know what is the processes, but how exactly it works, we don't know. Because it depends. And you have heard me saying that a lot of times it depends, but you will also hear other people say it depends. So so in my presentation, you will recognize a lot of things that Robin also said, but that means that we have agreed on some scientific stuff. So first of all, who was here last year? Oh, so I don't have to repeat some of the things that I prepared, because, you know, for me, I always start with this, the prelude. Because I think it's very important that we keep in mind, why do we do the research? And we do it because we, as a fire service, we wanted to prevent fires, and we wanted to innovate the fire suppression. Innovate fire suppression to make it safer for our firefighters and more effective. And for that innovation, we do the research, but also to prevent the fires. And for both of these sides of the bow tie, we need to know how fire works. We need to know the causes. We need to know how it develops, and we need to know how to put it out. And we need to base that on evidence. Evidence from practice or evidence from research. So that is why we do it. It's not because Ricardo likes it or it is a hobby or something, but we need the research to get more knowledge about it. We do it in 4 different ways. Because experiments are very nice, but most of the time, the experiments only give the answer for one specific situation. And we know that there is many factors playing a role in how fire develops and how fire behaves. So we need more than that. We also need data. We need to know how many times did the fire grow farther than, for example, the fire room? How many times was it originating in the object of origin? How many people did we rescue, for example? That kind of data we need. We also need to know a lot about practical fires. And we didn't do that very often, but lately, the past few years, since we have our fire investigation teams, of which I'm very proud of, because without the fire investigation teams, I think we would not be able to get so many cases, real cases, that we can study. The study of real cases in combination with data and our experiments gives answers, I think. And there is a rather new one that we also use to understand what happened. It is the fire safety engineering, and that is where fire engineering and fire suppression come together, because we can use the modeling to understand what happened in a real fire, and that is what we are doing lately. And I think that knowledge is very important. So we combine the four pieces of knowledge together and find answers. For us, it is very important, and of course, we copied that from Robin, because that we do it together with firefighters. So it is a participative, practical research. When it comes to research in a laboratory, we don't do it as a fire service academy, because we want to do it together with firefighters, and we want to give practical answers to questions that we have in practice. So that's what I tell you every year. Yes, you recognize it? So for the people that were not here last year, they know why we do it. And for me, it is 10 years of fire safety engineering conference, so I thought, where was I 10 years ago? 2007, I was still managing somewhere, not aware of that there is a fire safety engineering conference at that time, because it was for prevention, yes? This was only prevention. And nowadays, of course, we mix it up. So in 2010, René, he asked me, can you tell us something about the vision of the fire service in relationship with fire safety engineering? And it was for me the first time, so 7 years ago, the first time that I attended here. Later on, you see in 2012, I became a professor. So I could tell something about a very, very little of research that we did at that time, 2012. And in 2013, the senior professor, he decided that I could be a chairman. So I was that, and I don't know if he was happy with that, because the past years after that, I gradually took you with me in the research that we did. And of course, it started with very small research, and now, last year, I could give you an overview of all the research, and we could put it together into the theory of the predictable outcome. You remember? The theory of the... that theory has had a little bit of evolution, development. So I will tell you about that today. And then I will go into the subject that I wanted to stress, is the smoke. And I think that we have an issue with smoke. So first of all, an overview of the research that we did in the past, maybe 4 or 5 years, very big projects. Project in Zutphen, which was meant to find out if we could find a way of how fire develops in the home. And the main conclusion was that we cannot predict it, because there is too many factors playing a role. So this is also a very important conclusion. But in the meanwhile, we also looked at this tenability for people who would be inside. And we found out indeed the same as in the United States. If you are behind the door, then you will survive longer. So fire service could rescue you. Also very important, the advices that we give about the smoke alarms, because we were used to have the smoke alarms only in the hallways, and now we found out it is better to have them in every space. Yeah, so very important conclusions. Other big research that we did was into the quadrant model, especially the offensive outside exterior attack. And we discovered that there were a lot of techniques that could possibly help us put out the fire from outside, but the most important thing is that you know where to put it. So that was, for us, it was an eye-opener, because we thought that we would develop techniques, and the conclusion was that we should do a better reconnaissance, better size-up to put the water where the fire is. Other big research, it is not. I will not go into that too much, but it is really important, because we were doing research into the command and control system. Not only the structure, but we found out that the human factor is very important. Human factor in decision-making and the pressure. And we found out, was very important, that we are imperfect. We are not perfect as a human being. So we make a lot of mistakes when we make decisions under pressure. And that meant that we have to find ways to improve that, especially directed to the human beings. Of course, all the research that is being done in the United States, so that's why I'm happy that we have good acquaintances. I think we incorporate them in our new lessons and also in our knowledge. So I'm very happy that we can use all that knowledge. Together, I put it together. And last year, it was still the theory of the predictable outcome, but it has developed a little bit. So nowadays, we call it the refreshed view on firefighting. And why refreshed? Because we found out that in theory, we know everything. But somehow, in practice, we don't act like what we know. Yeah? So I think that nothing will be new. But for me, 5 steps. The first step is take a little bit more time. If you take more time, you will see more. And we have time, because if we leave the building closed, no oxygen will be going to the fire, so the fire will stay small. We have time. First, take more time. It's to improve your situation awareness. From the offensive exterior attack experiments, we learned that it is very important to find the right entrance or the right place where you put your fire. So it means that you should do a good reconnaissance and try to put out the fire from outside if it is possible. Step 3, also from the offensive exterior attack, is if we know where the fire is and we can reach it and we have enough water, we put it out. Everybody agrees on that. Yes, I think. But when I say if you don't have enough water, you cannot put it out. Okay, everybody agrees, still agrees, I think. But if you cannot reach it, or you don't know where it is, it is still a predictable outcome, because you will not put it out. And then people start getting a little bit nervous, because they think, okay, so if you cannot put it out from outside, of course we cannot put it out. For industrial buildings, I think this rule goes a lot of time. But maybe for dwellings or homes, we will still go inside. And if you go inside, I thought that there would be a theory where you can say, like, okay, we have scenarios, and in different scenarios, we have different ways of working. And we found out that it is always the same that is important. If you ask, how much water do we need? That is something that was not in our lessons until now. And that is because the scientists didn't agree on how much water you need to put out the water. And of course, the amount of water you need to put out the fire is depending on the magnitude of the fire, yes? On the heat release rate. So we developed a few rules of thumb for you to use in case of fire. And we see that it helps firefighters a lot to think in this way, because we still see firefighters or colleagues trying to put out a fire with a high pressure hose of 150 liters, where we see that the heat release rate of that fire is too big to put it out with a high pressure hose. So, but then the question is, of course, how much water do I need and how can I put it out? So we have some rules of thumbs. And it will surprise you that for a warehouse of maybe 1,000 square meters, you need 50 low pressure hoses to put it out. I didn't know that when I was an officer in charge. So I just thought we do our best, and if it doesn't work, then okay, we did our best, yes? So, but the most important thing is, and Robin also mentioned it, and that is that we found out that we forgot something very important over the past decennia. And I cannot stress it more, and I'm very happy that Robin also did it, and probably everybody, all the experts that we had in the Netherlands this week stressed that the most important thing is the oxygen. And why did we forget to close the door? And why did we put out windows? Why would we, if we could, and we, of course, we don't want to do it like the Americans do it on the roof. If we could make holes in the roof, we would do it, yes? So we have to realize that the amount of oxygen that goes to the fire determines how big the fire will be. So we have to learn to close the doors. And what we can see also in this picture, in the last picture, you can see RSTV. For the foreigners, probably it will be safer. Yes, the The acronym will be BSAFER. For us in the Netherlands, RSTV. We have been teaching a lot of firefighters the RSTV model to recognize the smoke and to recognize the color of the smoke, the density of the smoke, the flames, the temperature, etc. And we noticed that for a lot of firefighters, this is rather difficult to apply in practice. So theoretically, okay, excellent. But in practice, it is very difficult. So what I do is I take all the experts in the Netherlands and ask them, can we make it more simple? And after some discussions, they said, yes, it can. And then it turns out to be the fire triangle, which we knew already maybe for now many, many, many years. So because R, the smoke, it's fuel, yes? Smoke is fuel, no matter how dense it is fuel. Temperature is one side of the triangle. S, the stroming, yes, is oxygen supply. Oxygen is the other, the third one. And if you have them all three, you have flames. So you recognize RSTV? So RSTV is a nice theory, but we can still use our triangle. And when you go to a fire, there will be fuel, there will be temperature, or there will be an ignition source. So the oxygen is very important. And we forgot about that. So I cannot stress it more. And maybe more speakers today will talk about that. But the oxygen is something we should take into account more often. So this, we did some exercise and we were talking about what kind of scenarios can you have. So there were four. The flames coming out, nothing is coming out, or smoke is coming out. And we thought that you could have maybe some kind of procedure for one of for everyone. But it turned out that the procedure is the same for every situation. And the first one is door control. It is the most important one. If you can reduce the amount of oxygen which can flow to the fire, you will keep it small. Fast water on the fire. So don't hesitate, it is the same. Yes, Robin also says, and all the experts agreed on that yesterday, water on the fire, don't forget to do that. Gas cooling, very nice, but put water on the fire as fast as possible if you can. Gas cooling was one of our main questions, and I will go into that later on, because we didn't understand quite what it did. And the question we had was, is it okay that we do it? Do we harm anything? Do we have the right perception of what the effect of gas cooling would be? And is it worthwhile to teach all our firefighters how to do it? Because it is a lot of work, and it is very difficult to do it. So this is the refreshed view on firefighting, and we had a question about gas cooling, but we have more questions. Because within the quadrant model, we are still puzzling about how to prevent fire spread with as least the least water. So the most effective way to prevent fire spread from one building to another. We still don't really know how it works. Of course, when you have a lot of water, of course, then you just put a lot of water on it, but we want to find out how we can do it with the least water, because the water will be polluted. So environmentally, it is not so good to use a lot of water. Defensive interior attack. So to prevent fire spread near the fire wall, it's rather a puzzle for us. We don't really know how to do it. I would like to do experiments. But we need 20 industrial buildings with a firewall to do that. So if anybody here has maybe knows where we can find 20 industrial buildings to do the experiments, then let me know, because then I will be the first to... Yes? So we have to find other ways to do it. And I will go into that later. So now the update. So this was a little bit repetition of last year, but I think for the people that didn't know, and the refreshment, it is very, very nice to know. So, 2017. First, of course, I'm proud that I can present that we have two English reports and also one Dutch report, because we have the summary of 3 years of experiments in the offensive exterior attack, and we summarized it in a very small booklet. Did you find it? Did you know about that? It's really very, I can advise you to read it, because there is also a very good perspective how to deal with fires regarding that research. And we have now also translated it to English, and we will hand it over today, also for our foreign guests. In that offensive exterior attack, we have a perspective. It is like a procedure. And of course, it is not I don't think that we need that procedure and stand in front of the building and look what we are going to do. It is like a mental frame. So you can practice it a little bit. What can we do in this situation? What can we do in that situation? And of course, people are asking me, Ricardo, but how does it? So this is a kind of procedure, and you also have the refreshed view on firefighting. So how does it come together? So like this. Yeah, so when you add a little bit of that defy triangle, yes, and you add a little bit of, take a little bit more time. And of course, you do outside reconnaissance, and you put out the fire from outside. And the body is from Obi. Yes, it's from the offensive outside exterior attack experiments. The offensive inside attack is also connected. And then you know how much water you know. So there is again the refreshed view on. Yes, so you can see that the perspective that we made from. The perspective is connected in the total. Yes, yes. So the perspective of that you can find in the summary report is the body, is in fact the body of the refreshed view on firefighting. So, and then the gas cooling. So this was for us was a big question. Maybe the question is solved now because we had a very good discussion yesterday with our foreign experts on that. But what was the problem? Well, the problem was one of our first experiments we did was on gas cooling. And what we saw was these kind of sinus things in the temperature. So every time you put a pulse, of course, it cools the gases, but immediately the temperature starts rising again. And when we saw that, we thought, hey, this is strange, because we were thinking that when you cool the gases, it would be safe, because the purpose of cooling the gases would be to create a safe environment to go to the fire. Yes or no? So if we do that, people were thinking probably if you cool the gases and you can just go as far as you want. But of course, theory says as long as you don't put out the fire, it will create energy. So you will have to keep on cooling the gases. And then the question is, how far can you do that? How far can you go into a building, cooling the gases, and still have a safe environment? So that was the question that we had, and we didn't know. So we wanted to know, to which extent is gas cooling effective? And then, of course, the question is, if that extent is only very small, so why do we do it? Because if you can put water on the fire, it is, of course, the best way of cooling gases. So if the space where it is effective can be only very small, like in the books, 70 square meters, I could put water on the fire. So why do we cool the gases? Is it necessary or not? So this is a question that we had, and we didn't know. So we wanted to do experiments in that. But first we started with a literature study. Look what is in literature about it, about gas cooling. The first thing when we put together all the literature, we see that there is a lot of literature about droplets, about cooling gases with droplets, the size of the droplet and the speed of the droplet and that kind of thing. So a lot of things are known and measured in laboratory experiments about gas cooling. But what we were thinking is, so can it be that there is another effect? Because everybody talks about inertization or dilution with steam, because the steam that is created during the cooling would not only cool, but also, of course, change the composition of the gases. And if you combine that with the knowledge that even gases at 20 degrees can ignite in the right composition with the right ignition source, so is cooling the only effect that we want to achieve with gas cooling? Maybe it is gas changing. Somebody said it yesterday, maybe it is gas changing until it is a safe situation. So we wanted to know, is it really safe and how far can we use it? Of course, we have the latest studies from Lund, from Matthias van der Ve. Is he here? No, he's not here. Most of the time he is here, but he did the studies also into cooling. And of course, the newest book, Eurofirefighter, who has it? So somebody has it. Did you read it also? Okay. Because Paul Greenwood is of course also an expert on a lot of things. He did research also, and he has a whole chapter about cooling. And when you read that chapter, you see that it seems to be that there is two kind of religions. The U.S. religion put a lot of water on it, and more maybe the Swedish religion, who is more into gas cooling and 3D and don't touch the... So I'm very happy that yesterday we could talk about this with all these experts from Sweden and the United States, and it seems that we agree that the first thing you should do is put water on the fire. That is the most important. Everybody agrees on that. The second one is gas cooling is maybe necessary if you want to go to a fire which cannot be reached immediately, but then it is not so critical where you can put the water. So put the water on the ceiling and the walls, it doesn't matter. And we found out that there is one myth that we should also address. That is the myth that if you put water in the against the walls and the windows, the walls and the ceiling, that you will get a lot of steam. That's a myth, yes? I also learned it. Don't put water in it because you get a lot of steam. So now the experts agree on that. That is not true. That is only true if you put too little water in it. But if you put a lot of water in it, you don't get steam. So think about that. So, but that means that it is not so critical. If you approach to a fire, you can put water also on the ceiling and the walls, but put a lot in it. So, also, what we found out in this discussion is that it is rather it is a very difficult process. And the question is, what do we really do when we extinguish a fire? I didn't think about it that, so I'm still learning also, but it seems that there is maybe five different processes. Wetting the surface, wetting the environment of the surface, cooling the gases, cooling the ceiling, cooling the flames, decrease radiation, changing the composition by steam. So it is a very difficult process, and nobody really understands in what... what is the relationship between those? So what is the most important thing that is happening when you put out a fire? So first I will make it a little bit complicated for you, but it is only to explain that we did not succeed in doing our experiments like we wish, because we thought it would be simple. You make smoke, you put water in it, and you measure the composition, and you can see when you know the temperature and you know the composition, you can see whether it still ignites. That is what we wanted to do. So we made a nice setup. We made a fire in one part and a smoke in the other part, and we tried to ignite the smoke. It didn't work. It did not work. While in the containers, of course, we see all the time that we can ignite the gases. And it did work from 10 times, two times we were able to ignite the smoke. And it was two times when the CO concentration, which was assumed the most important gas, was far below its lower explosion limit. So we were like, so we don't know anymore. Yes? It is very difficult. You can see it in this, maybe, I think this, you can see the black line is the carbon monoxide lower explosion limit, and we had an ignition far below that. And when you start looking into that, it gets complicated, because it seems now that, of course, we all have in mind explosion limits which are measured in 20 degrees atmospheric pressure in air with oxygen concentration of air, and then we know the lower explosion limit. For example, for carbon monoxide, it would be around 11%. But that is only in air at 20 degrees at atmospheric pressure. But that is not the situation we have in that container, because we have a higher temperature, we have a lower oxygen concentration, because the hot gases will be on top with lower oxygen. So we didn't know. We were stuck. But the question still remained, is it necessary to do these experiments? And I think that after yesterday, after we could exchange with our acquaintances all the knowledge that we have, that maybe we don't have to. So we have to discuss whether we go on with this situation, because I think it is rather clear for now There's nothing wrong with gas cooling, but we just have to keep in mind that the best way of gas cooling the gases is put water on the fire. So don't spend time in gas cooling if it is not necessary. That is the first thing that everybody is agreeing on. But the most important thing is keep the door closed, because no oxygen, no fire, yes? Gas cooling when you approach the fire is still a very good idea, but be careful, not in a too big room. So that is the advice that we can give you for now. Probably it doesn't change much in what we already knew, but not how we practice it. So then another thing. We had two other questions. Question about the defensive outside attack and the defensive interior attack. And these are very difficult to do experiments with. So we have to try to find another way. And learning from practice is, I think, very important. And we didn't show each other the presentations, but it is also the same way that we went in, to learn from actual fires, together with firefighters out of the country. We wrote a book about it, Learning in the Fire Service, and we already started two projects, Action Research, Action Learning. One project is with the bundles, the low-pressure bundles, with four regions and 10 fire stations we are trying out. And another project is with the command and control, the incident command. 60 fire officers in four regions are trying out our new safety net for human factors. And we learn together with them. So they are, in fact, the researchers. And we support them and we collect the knowledge and we share the knowledge. Example of the bundles. This is the scheme, almost the same. I didn't see your scheme, Robin, but it's almost the same scheme. So for the bundles, for example, it is something new. So 10 fire stations try out how it works. We put it into our books, yes, together. It's an example of what we could do. Other examples, I wish that we could do that next year, because there is a lot of alternative extinguishing agents, like the extinguishing bomb, and there is F-500, and maybe there are more new. So I would like it very much if we could do the same kind of action learning projects with fire stations and find out how it works and do it together. The other thing could be a theme. For example, smoke explosions. We could, for example, have fire regions that collect for us the cases, and we can give meaning to that together and analyze it together. And you saw already the example of the HACO. If you want to know more about that, then go to the workshop of Liebe, because he has two cases, real cases, that he analyzed using the simulation models to understand what really happened. And we want to do that more. So if you feel like yet you want to participate in this kind of project, please let me know, because for next year we want to do that. And of course, action learning is something new for us, so we also have to learn how we have to do that kind of things. Then the last, the one before the last, yes? Smoke gas explosions. We knew maybe one in the Punt. 2008 was a smoke gas explosion. After that we had the Westvlietweg, but still it seemed like it was an exception. In 2016, as far as we know, we had 6 of these situations. And then it started bothering me, because it seems like that it is growing. 2015, 2016, 5 times, and even in family dwellings we saw them. Smoke explosions. And we want to know, how do they exist? What is the cause of them? And what can we do? Because what is bothering me is that we cannot see whether it is going to happen. Most of the time it doesn't happen. A short movie. Some examples. Examples from 2016. This is a fire in Boerden, I think. Harmelen. No, this is Opdam. In Opdam. Do you recognize it? Opdam. Yeah. So this is Rotterdam, Schiedam, Ringerstraat. Ja, respect them. And some of our colleagues were hurt in this explosion. Another one, this is IJmuiden. So, and you can see him think, who the hell did this? He still can't believe it. And this is Harmony. So, we don't know all of them, probably, because we don't collect them all. But I want to call to you to please report them all, because next year we want to collect them and try to find out what can we do. Because it seems now like a Russian roulette. Most of the times it goes okay, but sometimes it doesn't. And we want to find ways to prevent them. And also to predict them, because nowadays we are going inside the building, not knowing whether there is an explosive mixture, and it can be very dangerous. So we don't have a perspective for you what you can do, and we want to find out what. Of course, there has been some research already, and if you want to know more about this, go to the workshop of René de Feiter, because one of his students did some research, and of course. Previously, also the TU in Eindhoven did some research into this project, and we still don't really know what happened. Then, last, our book. Did you know the book? Who saw the book? Oh, there is still. So maybe we need some more promotion for this, because these are 20 cases, really happened fires, which. Colleagues all over the country sent to us, together with the fire investigation teams, and we were able to put them together and also find some trends, because we know firefighters don't learn from fires that occur only once. They want to learn from fires that occur more than one time. So, and I think that we found here one of the most important trends that we did not, that at least I was not aware of, we were not aware of, and one of the things is the smoke spread. Through the buildings. And after we published this book, three times, we already had a fire in an apartment building where the smoke was everywhere and we had to put out all the people, which is rather new because, as you know, I also was an officer in charge years ago, but I never evacuated the building. We always left the people in their rooms. We put out the fire, ventilate, and everybody was okay. And nowadays, it seems that all the fires that we have in apartment buildings, they seem to produce so much smoke, and the smoke spread is so much that we have to evacuate the buildings. And that is, of course, quite a different situation. So our advice is that we should not be overwhelmed with that anymore, because we know now that if we go to a fire, even a small fire in an apartment building, we know that the smoke spread will be probably more than we expect. And, of course, in relationship with the fact that that the resilience of a lot of people is decreasing because elderly people are living independently in these kind of buildings, we have a lot of work. That raises the question, do we first have to rescue or first have to put out the fire? And we don't have the answer yet, but we know now that if we have a small fire and we can reach it and we have enough water, put it out first, because evacuating the whole building is a hell of a job, and you cannot do that with one engine. But if you are not sure, you have a big problem. And we say it is a dilemma for the first crew leader that arrives. What we also can see is that a lot of fires develop contra-intuitively. So it is not like you expect, because buildings are built differently than they used to be built. So our experience thus is not always a good advisor. We always have to make a good size-up before we decide what to do. Our experience can fool us. And then last but not least, we found also trends in fire suppression. And these trends can be related to the refresh view. So if we take the refreshed view of firefighting into account, we can probably fight a lot of fires better. And then, too close, because I see the chairman is getting a little bit nervous. So, do you understand this picture? So we already said that big fires, a lot of water, yes? Small fires, little water. But now, of course, we can add to that a lot of oxygen, big fires, a lot of water, little oxygen, doors closed, small fires, small water. Yeah? No fire, no oxygen, no fire. Robin, of course, Robin has more. Even in the United States, they think it is like that. So. Okay, and then last but not least, we had, of course, our action. Hey, do the deur dicht. It is from Zutphen. But in the United States, they are one step ahead, and they say, close before you doze. And it goes for the civilians, and it goes for the firefighters. And for the firefighters, close before you doze is close the door before you put water. So I think that we can maybe also take over or adopt that trend. And we really have to, if there is one thing that you have to remember when you go out, that is close before you doze. Close that door. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ricardo. I was wondering if we have a very famous Dutch football player. I think when he was here, he would have said, firefighting is simple, but the most difficult is simple firefighting.
Okay, yes. Well, that's very philosophical.
Questions? Oh, yes, I can throw a lot.
Mike. Yeah.
It's in the corner. Whoop-a. Whoop.
Thank you, Ricardo. As ever, really interesting presentation. And you're very strong on the message about reduce the oxygen levels and you won't have a fire. But I wonder whether you are you completely dismissing controlled ventilation of to improve the conditions? Because whilst you're right, without oxygen, the fire is dying down. You still have got very, very high temperatures in a room. And when you're looking at offensive exterior attack, a tactic of using things like controlled ventilation, positive pressure ventilation, and so on, are you going to consider that in your research as a firefighting tactic? Because it's counterintuitive in some ways, but you will have seen it reducing, whilst increasing the intensity of a fire, actually reducing temperature within a compartment.
Yes. Well, to be honest, yes. And that is also because there has been some research by UL also into positive pressure ventilation. And that showed that it is very important to have first water on the fire before you ventilate. So it is a very difficult process to understand everything that is going on inside the building. And of course, if you have a simple container with a small fire, everything will work. But as soon as this gets more complicated inside the building and you don't know exactly how the building is organized inside, whether the doors are open or closed, you never know what you are doing. So my advice would be not to do that. And there's another reason. Of course, nothing can be sure. But you say that if you keep the things closed, temperature will go up. But probably that is not the case. Probably because there is no oxygen. The fire will smother. So it will continue to create smoke, but it will probably not get hotter. It gets hotter when you open the door. And that is what we see in all our experiments. As soon as you open the door, temperature within seconds rise from maybe 150 degrees to 600 degrees. It goes really very fast. So what you are doing when you put oxygen into the building, probably you deteriorate the tenability for the victims. of course, depending on the place where the victim is. Because if he is behind the door or if he is in a room where there is no access for smoke or fire, then he will survive longer. So our professor, I don't know where he is, will say it depends. But for me, if you don't know what you're doing, then I'd rather not do it.
It's a high level.
Yes, but maybe you want to add something about that, maybe Robin, or because you did the research, I didn't.
I'd have to agree that you can't have temperature without fire, and you can't have fire without oxygen. So the temperature would go down. There is scenarios where you can improve conditions in one place while deteriorating them in another place, but they're so far in between, so far and few between, and they're so specific that it's almost as if we don't have an understanding exactly of when you're doing that and where you're doing that.
Thank you.
Yes.
Other questions? I think your story was
everybody's hungry.
Very complete.
I think everybody's hungry.
Yeah. You know, perhaps you know, when you hear the presentations and from the perspective of the firefighter, you know, when theories are a bit changing, you know, 2 years ago tactical A was good, and now it's more tactical B. If you're a firefighter, and we have a lot of them, it's difficult to choose what's my perspective, what should I do with all those theories, because, you know, I learned 2 years ago method A, and now they say it's more like method B.
Yes, I understand because I, of course, I do also this presentation in fire stations. But in my opinion, I think that over the past few years we made it too complicated for the average firefighter. So firefighters are confused because they got a lot of theory, but they don't know how to apply it. And what I try to do is to make it simple again, so everybody can understand and easy to apply. So and like something like opening and closing doors. It is something that is not in our system anymore, but it is in our theory. So we just don't do it, but we know that it is important. So for me, in my opinion, we make it more simple for them to extinguish fires. But my impression is that they like it. But of course, here's a room full of firefighters who can.
Are there firefighters in the room who are a bit confused of all the theories last years? No? Well, and then your story is good, simple.
Okay.
Oh. Ricardo, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. And I think we have a presentation. You will.
Project leader Rijk van de Dikkenberg will do it, but
I'll do the introduction for this kind of thing. As Ricardo, should I use a mic?
I'll get you a mic.
Okay. As Ricardo told us already, we did a major program, a research program on the offensive exterior attack for the last 5 years. We conducted 4 large full-scale experiments. We made 4 very big scientific reports, which were very suitable for our colleagues, but not for the common firefighter who was on the incident scene. So they asked us make a small report with things we can understand and use when we're on the incident scene. And we did. It was a very small report. And this morning you make a call to bring it also in English so the foreign colleagues can also read our belongings of our findings, and I'm glad to present to you the first translated report. And as we speak, it's now also available on internet, I believe, and on the hashtag Twitter. I don't know the Twitter hashtag.
It's for the Netherlands.
I never Twitter. You see.
Yeah. It's the first time we talk English to each other.
Yes, it is. Normally we talk Turkish, but now
it's the same. They understand it.
Okay.
Thank you. We had ook
for the picture.
For the picture.
Well, what's very important is that it's one of the main topics in Europe, in all the countries, that we say if you do research, please do it as well in English, because there's a lot of research in Europe, but mostly in their mother language, and it's very difficult to read. I know this in Sweden as well, a lot of research, and I know Stefan Svensson is sitting there somewhere. Where is he? At the back. So we had a discussion, Mr. Svensson, Stefan. Should we translate it all in English, or should all the people in the Netherlands learn Swedish? thank you. Okay, Ricardo, thank you.